Welcome, and thank you for joining us on today's special ACA Connects webinar, Building Successful Broadband Adoption Programs, Insights from the Field. I'm Tamika Slappy, ACA Connects Assistant to the President and CEO. Today's webinar will be recorded and made available within 48 hours on ACA Connects website. Now, with some opening remarks, allow me to introduce Matt Polka, ACA Connects President and CEO. Matt, over to you.
Thank you, Tamika, and thank you as always for your kind help in organizing our many, many webinars that we do at ACA Connects. And we're very, very pleased to have you here today, where we're talking about the next era of broadband adoption and digital inclusion. We've been looking forward to this lively panel discussion from a range of different perspectives across the industry, all working towards a common goal, and that's to make sure that we get every household connected in our country subscribing to high-speed broadband. You know, it's been an exciting time for our ACA Connects members over the last couple of years. Despite the problems that we've all encountered with the pandemic, they have expanded their broadband footprint to connect even more and more of their customers and their communities. But they've also been able to reach out to those that were in need, whether they couldn't afford broadband or had problems affording the equipment for broadband or even understanding why broadband was so important. Our members have been vitally a part of the Emergency Broadband Benefit Program at the FCC. And we're looking forward to the additional $14.2 billion that will be made available in the infrastructure bill that hopefully will be passed soon to help further connect Americans across the country. So we're very, very happy to have this discussion today. It's so critical for our country and for Americans who aren't connected to broadband, helping them to understand why it's so important for them to connect or helping them to connect financially. So we're going to be looking at the lessons learned over the last couple of years, what the next steps are, and how we can get more and more people online soon. We brought together for you today a distinguished panel of experts from all across the industry, from various points of view, to help us in this discussion about getting people connected. And it's really reflective of the complexity and the importance of this issue that all work together to try to help get Americans connected to broadband. So let's move forward with this rich discussion today. And I'm pleased to pass the mic over to our SVP of Government Affairs, Ross Lieberman, who will lead us in the next section to talk about our ACA Connects broadband plan, focusing on adoption and turning things over for our panel today. So Ross, over to you.
Thanks, Matt. And good afternoon to our panelists and many attendees. Our report, Addressing Gaps in Broadband Infrastructure and Service Adoption, examined both the availability of and adoption rates for high-speed broadband service. Among its many findings, the report showed the adoption gap to be the far greater driver of the digital divide in America. While broadband, as defined by the FCC, is not available to 12 million households, our report estimates that 30 million households do not subscribe despite having access. Notably, this is a problem that spans both rural and non-rural areas. About 30% of households are non-adopters, regardless of geography. Non-subscribers have many reasons for not connecting to the internet, but not having sufficient income is a common one. Among the non-subscribers, 36% have an annual income below $20,000. However, as our panelists can attest, even if the price of broadband is zero, other barriers remain, ranging from lack of connected devices to low digital literacy. To assist policymakers working on the bipartisan infrastructure framework, our report included cost estimates for various options for subsidizing the cost of broadband service and for improving digital literacy. And through this lens, our evaluation now of the bill that passed the Senate suggests the legislation's ambitions are achievable with its funding allocations. As Matt mentioned, the bill allocated $14.2 billion to fund a broadband subsidy program. This program would provide $30 per month to eligible households to offset the cost of any participating provider's broadband service offerings. The infrastructure package also included $2.75 billion for two digital inclusion grant programs. In the first, the states receive money to support projects that improve digital literacy and broadband adoption activities. And in the other, the NTIA awards money for these purposes. Our panel of experts have closely examined the root causes of non-adoption, how to structure a robust subsidy program, and what successful adoption and digital inclusion programs look like. And we are excited to hear from them about what the future holds. With that, I'll turn it over to Gabriella Novello, Assistant Editor of Communications Daily, to kick off the discussion. Once again, thank you all for taking part, and we look forward to the conversation today.
All right, thanks, Ross. So welcome everyone, and thank you for tuning in to today's discussion on broadband adoption. As Ross mentioned, my name is Gabriella Novello. I'm an assistant editor with Communications Daily. We've got a great group of experts to chat with us today and really dive into why the broadband adoption gap still exists, the effectiveness of existing and the pandemic related programs, as well as what policymakers should consider as we look forward. Joining us this afternoon, we have Jonathan Bullock, Executive Vice President of Corporate Development and Government for Hotwire Communications, Whitney Kimball, Director of National Programs for the Center for Rural Strategies, Yosef Getachew, Media and Democracy Program Director for Common Cause, and Hannah Hill, Principal for Boston Consulting Group. So I'd like to start us off with something that Ross said, and that's the anticipated broadband funding in Congress's upcoming infrastructure package. Now, Congress is poised to make a sizable investment in broadband in this package, but with it unlikely to include the estimated full amount needed to have far-reaching and reliable broadband everywhere, what should policymakers prioritize in terms of administering these funds? Whitney, would you like to kick us off?
Sure. Hi, everyone. My name is Whitney Kimball Coe, and again, I'm with the Center for Rural Strategies, and we've been working in the broadband space for many years now. We have a rural broadband policy working group through our organization, and a lot of our efforts truly have been focused on the access side of the issue. The Benton Institute for Broadband and Society reports that, an estimate is that about 20 million or 26 million rural residents do not have access to fixed broadband. I know that kind of contradicts some of what Matt was offering about this issue of adoption, but I want to say that access and adoption are something that go hand in hand in a lot of ways when it comes to rural and tribal areas. So addressing one piece of that, it will improve adoption on the other end of that. I think a number of the programs that have come out in this last year in response to the pandemic have addressed some of the issues that the Rural Broadband Policy Working Group and others have been advocating for a long time, which is, making sure we subsidize access, making sure that families can afford broadband if it is available in their area. So the EPP was a really important program for rural people and places, though sometimes it broke down when it came time to get that connection through the providers, because there were some providers that didn't participate that were in rural areas. And also there were some providers that were using this as an opportunity to upcharge these families. So thinking about how these programs can either work with providers in ways that yield equitable results, or go straight to a consumer-focused engagement strategy with people on the ground, with the consumers themselves, I think is really important going forward.
And Hannah, I saw you nodding a little bit, so I'd love to jump to you next. With the infrastructure package's inclusion of grants for states to promote digital literacy as well as broadband adoption, how should state and local leaders prioritize those efforts, especially in communities where there may be trust or information barriers?
Sure, and hi, everyone. I'm Hannah Hill. I'm a principal at the Boston Consulting Group. And I've spent much of the past year plus exclusively focused on efforts around the digital divide, partnering with Common Sense Media and the Gates and the Walton Foundation on efforts related to what's the size and nature and how to close the digital divide in education. We partnered with Comcast, and I think that's most pertinent to your question, Gabriella, on some research around barriers to adoption, especially in areas where broadband is available and affordable because it is offered through no-cost programs at the school. And then also partnering with different municipalities as they build out their broadband strategy. Specifically, as you were relating around information and trust barriers, so we conducted some research and we fielded a survey nationally with close to 3,000 responses to look at what are the barriers to adoption in school-sponsored programs. So during the pandemic, schools really looked at their students and said there are so many people who don't have access and can't be learning from home if they do not have that access. And there were partnerships stood up in place, sponsored service programs in which between internet providers, schools, philanthropic organizations covering the cost of the internet. So that it was offered at no cost to students, it was available and they needed to learn. And they were finding that there were still several students that were, or many students really, the majority were not still connected. And so we really sought out to understand why. And I think a few things that came up, and I think addressing these barriers is what's important as we think about the funds coming down the way. But there were information and trust barriers, people who struggled to understand, did they qualify? They thought it was for people needier than them. They struggled to navigate the application and the installation process, especially when you're looking at a process that requires multiple steps or is dealing with technology for a population that is students and parents and grandparents who are using internet for the first time. And also many trust barriers around, you say it's no cost, but I think to Whitney's point, it's like, am I going to get upcharged? Is there going to be unexpected costs? And even if it seems like a compelling offer, it can be really scary when you're already struggling to meet basic needs around food or rent. And also concerns around giving information around needing to provide Social Security or other information that can feel very invasive, especially if you're concerned about immigration status or debt collectors. And so I think as we think about just to answer your question around prioritizing funds, it's really about how can you create clear channels of communication and expand support. And I think we've seen models in which schools, libraries, churches, grocery stores have really stood up. You see it with the vaccine as well, but to be a voice, to share trusted messengers, to support people one-on-one and really walk them through the process and help them navigate that information. And creating those ecosystems of support is incredibly important.
And Jonathan, when you think about the broadband adoption gap that we're still seeing, I mean, how do you tease out the contributing factors, whether it's price, perceived need, or perhaps even, you know, as we were just discussing, the lack of really understanding, you know, maybe what broadband is and how to access it?
Yeah, I think there's, you know, they can divide the sort of two categories. One is the category I think Whitney faces, which is a lack of infrastructure. And to the extent that there's not broadband infrastructure in place in rural communities to get internet to homes, like that's always just going to be a fundamental barrier that's bigger than the adoption issue. And as we continue to spend money on like on non-permanent, non-final solutions on addressing that infrastructure issue, you're going to continue to face that. And so, you know, ahead of all of the other considerations on the rural side, you have to address the infrastructure problem. On the urban side, and we're kind of unique because we operate in both spaces. We find that, you know, the same kind of issues Hannah talked about. We have trust issues. We've been offering a low-income $10 or 150 meg internet package for years. And, you know, the adoption rates were never as high as we would have expected them to be. But it wasn't until COVID hit that we realized how low they actually were. I'm speaking with local schools, local government officials, housing authority folks, and we realized, you know, they're not just not getting it from us. They're not getting it from anywhere. And, you know, it's mostly a trust issue. It's a digital literacy issue. It's all of these things. So we try to encounter that through our charitable organization where we give away free internet to low-income communities by trying to come up with creative solutions, working with trusted community partners like housing authorities, charter schools, churches. We put Wi-Fi in churches a lot and for after school care. We also try to do unique technology solutions like ubiquitous Wi-Fi and housing authority development where you don't have to sign up to get it. But we make sign up something of a benefit for folks that are willing to do it. So to the extent there are subsidy programs, we could take advantage of those for those folks. But again, that's a place where you have infrastructure and you're subsidizing an operating expense, which, you know, can be relatively low. Getting past those hurdles, though, it seems to be a costly piece for us.
And, on the monthly subsidy programs, when you think about the anticipated $30 a month broadband subsidy that's in this infrastructure package, how can the implementation of the emergency broadband benefit program be leveraged to ensure that this new program is successful? And then on the other hand, is that $30 a month enough given the current pace of enrollment in EBB and the amount of money that is still left in that program?
Sure. Thanks, Gabriella. And thanks to ACA for inviting me to speak on this panel. My name is Yosef Getachew. I'm the Media and Democracy Director at Common Cause. For those who are unfamiliar, Common Cause is a 50 plus year old organization focused on democracy issues. We work at the center of technology and democracy as part of our Media and Democracy program, and really trying to figure out how to make sure broadband connectivity can support civic engagement and participation in our democracy in an equitable way. To take a step back before I jump into your question, your initial question was about what was our reactions to the current bipartisan infrastructure framework? I see this bill, and given that it might be coming up for a vote today, as a strong down payment to addressing the digital divide. One of the really strong pieces of this bill is the fact that it's addressing both deployment as well as affordability and digital equity and adoption. All three have been significant barriers and disparities when it comes to broadband access and adoption. That being said, I think implementation plays a major role, given the fact that these investments are not permanent investments in many cases. And we have already seen some of the lessons learned from the Emergency Broadband Benefit Program, as you alluded to. So to really dive into your question, we've seen about 6 million plus households enrolled in the Emergency Broadband Benefit so far, which is a great start. But that being said, if you look at just the eligibility numbers, there's around 36 million or so households that are eligible for this program based on Lifeline's eligibility alone. So that just shows you there's a lot more work to do to make sure that households that are eligible are adopting and are aware of this program. So one of the things that we need to build on from EBB into what the new program will be called ACP or the Emergency Connectivity Program is outreach and education. How do we make sure we have enough resources and investments to reach people who are hard to reach, who may not be online right now, or who may speak non-English languages and many materials that are understandable for their purposes to know what the program is all about. On addition to that, it's gonna be the subsidy you mentioned. So one of the changes from EBB to ACP is gonna be the decrease in subsidy from $50 to $30. At the same time, there's also gonna be some eligibility changes too. So one of the eligibility criteria under EBB is making sure that you meet the poverty threshold. So right now it's 135% below the poverty line. Under ACP, it's gonna be 200% below the poverty line. So what ACP is doing is expanding the eligibility scope, but also at the same time, lowering the subsidy level from 50 to 30. I think we're gonna have to see how that plays a role in getting households enrolled and whether or not that $30 is going to meet the communications needs. Understandably, it's being done to extend the amount of the funds, but at the same time, we'll have to see what enrollment looks like, what services look like, and how carriers participate in this new program. the last point I'll make is that one of the changes under ACP is going to be that carriers who do participate in the program have to include all of their current services. They can't just pick and choose like they've done under EBB. So that being said, we will see more services that do meet that $30 subsidy threshold. The question is going to be how many of those services are going to be high speed, robust versus ones that aren't as robust.
So on the issue of speeds, you know, Jonathan, if most people don't necessarily need, you know, super fast broadband speeds for their day-to-day use, you know, why do you think that many ISPs, you know, often mention how fast their services can be in their marketing or policy materials? I mean, is that an important factor that you think consumers look for? And on the other hand, I mean, where do you see 5G and eventually 6G playing a role in adoption?
You know, for us, the speed is not so much a measure of speed, but a capacity. And so as you add more devices in the home, the average homes by the next 3 or 4 years are going to have over 50 devices in each home. Being able to throughput the capacity needed to provide those connected devices to the internet in a real way is, you know, pretty serious. Additionally, you know, just the demand for internet use is, if you have an operator that's operating at a 40 or 50% penetration in its market and that increases with more adoption, you have more stress on the network. So being able to provide, you know, that capacity on your core network and all the way to the home is pretty critical to ensuring we have like we're getting the benefits of broadband, which are more than just getting on a Zoom call or watching a show on Netflix at night. It's economic development, it's civic participation, it's, you know, the community being able to manage crime, parking, traffic. There's a lot of things that go into having broadband infrastructure in your community. So it's not just speed, but speed is more important than people think, because it's really more of a measure of how big the pipe is. You know, at the end of the day, like 5G is great. It just is requires a lot of infrastructure in the ground. The, you know, the road to small cell is paved with fiber, and you don't get that without fiber at every street corner. And so you might as well put it in the home. Wireless stuff, wireless mobile broadband seems to be a little bit pricier, you know, to run, because you have capacity issues on spectrum that you don't have on wirelines. But it is certainly convenient. You know, I think until as a country we decide to put terminal infrastructure in the ground or, you know, into the air for broadband, we're going to continue to have to spend money upgrading it in a serious way, you know, year after year. It's a debt we're taking on for the future every time we don't put in real infrastructure.
And one of the things that you mentioned on, you know, especially the connected devices, you know, Whitney, when you think about digital equity and adoption, how do the availability of a connected device factor into whether or not a consumer chooses to adopt broadband? I mean, how important is that, especially when you also take into consideration the amount of EBB funding that has also gone into purchasing a connected device?
Yeah, for rural places and tribal nations, this is a really big issue. Affordability of devices is always going to be an issue. I think studies show that, you know, $10 a month is about the most a low-income person can afford to pay for broadband itself, but like 37% or so cite that the cost of the computer or the device is one of the reasons they don't have it at home. So it certainly is yet another barrier. One of the things I also wanted to make sure that we get to touch on here is not just about the devices, but going back to infrastructure and where it is and where it's not. We can't truly say we know at this point, because the data we have is really given to us by providers, and at this point funneled through the FCC. So providers are not necessarily on the hook to let us know if, you know, every person, every mailbox, in every community does have that access that they need. So it is a matter of, again, going back to that infrastructure piece, perhaps before we even talk about device connectivity. And of course, rural places are really diverse across population, but geography, there's no one size fits all for how to deploy this kind of infrastructure. And I would say that that diversity is something that needs to be brought into our understanding about how we're going to close this divide, the diversity of service and the needs there.
So even I know most folks agree, and I'm sure, you know, as Whitney, you've already said, and I'm sure some other folks do, the FCC is in dire need of new maps. But when you think about the data that's currently available for who is and is not adopting broadband when there is service available in their area, Yosef, what stands out to you and what kind of data is missing to really, you know, understand, you know, who is not adopting, why they're not adopting, and data that can be used to identify potential solutions to addressing the adoption gap?
Sure. So I think with data, it's all about granularity and how much of the data you have to make inferences. Obviously, what the data shows you or what it may tell you is going to be based on other aspects as well. So if we're talking about deployment specifically, the FCC is working on maps right now to update who has and who doesn't have access to broadband based off of location. And I think that alone can share some insight as to who may not be adopting simply because there is an infrastructure there. That being said, when we're looking at affordability or visual equity issues, we can look to see how households are adopting based on existing programs that are there. So I mentioned earlier, there are about 6 million households currently enrolled in the Emergency Broadband Benefit Program. The FCC did put out some data over the last few weeks and is continuing to put out data on what that 6 million population looks like. They're breaking it down based off of age as well as what eligibility they're signing up on, whether it's Medicaid, Medicare, or other assistance programs. This is all helpful just so you know, us as stakeholders and policymakers can see, okay, what are the most effective eligibility programs? How are households really signing up? The zip code information is particularly helpful because we can at least get down to a bit of a more granular level to see what zip codes are most enrolled, what zip codes are least enrolled. One of the interesting things that came out a few months ago was a report from John Horrigan at the Bennett Foundation, where he looked at very early data and saw that only 1 in 12 households were enrolling in EBB. And he actually looked at the most populous cities like LA and saw that the enrollment rate was actually a lot lower there compared to other smaller cities like maybe Baltimore. So again, it's really early to draw inferences on what that data means at this point when it comes to adoption, but those are the kind of studies that are important to see what are the adoption rates and how they differ from city to city to state to state. Last point I'll make is that we know that the most vulnerable communities and most important communities when it comes to programs like these are marginalized communities. So people of color, communities with disabilities, immigrant communities, those who speak multiple languages. One of the things that'd be incredibly helpful for the FCC and other stakeholders to do, as what John Horrigan did, is start overlaying some of the zip code data that we have now with census data to see where the gaps are. Where are there high populations of communities of color? Where are there low enrollment rates? That's something that us as stakeholders can look at to see, okay, where can our outreach and education efforts play a greater role in making sure these households enroll?
And when you think about education and outreach efforts, especially, you know, students may be going back to the traditional classrooms, but they still have to go home and do homework and have access to the internet. So, you know, staying on, you know, the topic of these pandemic related programs, Hannah, when you think about the Emergency Connectivity Fund's potential impact on students, do you think that it was designed to meet the long-term needs of students, or do you view this more of a short-term solution? And what kind of lessons do you think policymakers should take away as they continue working on, as Chairwoman Rosenworcel says, the homework gap.
I think there's still much to be seen as to how much of it will solve and for what time period. I think one thing that does stand out is the importance of institutions like schools and like libraries, institutions that are really touch points at a very person-to-person level in helping to close the digital divide. And in some ways it ties back to the data question that you were asking before. You can't solve a problem when you don't know what the problem is. And I think that we've seen really interesting examples of schools being able to have one-on-one connections with families or libraries to have people go in and be talking to them one-on-one to be able to say, this is what's challenging or keeping you from adopting the internet. Whether that's not understanding exactly the uses or not knowing how to navigate Excel or email. And so they are not using it as much as they might. To having questions about calling a call center and not getting through and not knowing the words. And so I think that really granular individual to individual connection and having those institutions that can have funding and to be able to be the center of the programs that can connect to households can be a really powerful tool to diagnose the problem and then address it to really drive adoption.
And Jonathan, you mentioned a little bit earlier when you were talking about some of the contributing factors to the adoption gap, what Hotwire has been working on, especially with helping low-income households. I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit more about some of the financial and educational models that Hotwire has found effective to reach consumers that may not necessarily know about their options, but want some form of service. I understand that Hotwire has taken a creative approach to this, but I'm hoping you can kind of dive into that a little bit more and what you found successful, what may be replicable, if that makes sense.
Yeah. As Hannah said, no one knows the broadband problem better than the schools, and they know exactly, and no one's probably done more to get devices in the hands of American households and schools. It's even hard to find a community that's in serious need of devices for students right now, because the schools have done such an effective job of distributing Chromebooks, MacBooks, all sorts of devices to the home in a pretty serious way. There's often maybe they're locked down too much and there's not an opportunity for the parents to take, learn digital literacy on those and to use it in the way that it should be. And it might be nice if schools could, learn to expand it, but partnering with schools is an enormous way to get the message out and to have a point of trust with the parents. We've done a lot of things. We've partnered with housing authorities to put in ubiquitous broadband in a housing authority development. We've partnered with schools to sign up people through the school. So instead of talking to an internet provider, they're talking to their school. And we've partnered with local governments where jointly we've built out infrastructure to every home and ensured that every home gets the opportunity to get internet. And I really like, in the situations where you don't have infrastructure, that's a really good one, because these are places that are never going to have enough money from infrastructure funding. And there's not a private business model to build out to these areas. And so having a model where the local government can help subsidize putting in the right infrastructure to get to every home and addressing those the equity issues around broadband deployment is really positive for everybody, because there's a financeable private business model on the private and operator side. And there's a functional important goal that the municipalities can meet with the resources that they have. They're unique to local governments, and I like that model a lot, because it solves the infrastructure issue. And on the adoption issue, just really focusing on digital literacy, being in churches, community centers, the schools, and getting to the parents, and the grandparents is very critical in building that trust. That's what we focus with Truist and Dell. We do programs on digital literacy where, and it's everything from just learning how to get on your school website to how do you take brain breaks? How do you do fun things? How do you do banking online as banks closing branches? How do you get to your DMV website is the number of physical locations have been reduced for civic and financial centers since COVID, and being able to instruct the parents on how to do that's been been a critical piece to the child's adoption for us.
And I'd like to dive a little bit more into the issue of digital literacy and how that impacts adoption. Whitney, when you think about the $2.75 billion in the infrastructure package that would go towards digital inclusion, grant programs to focus on digital literacy and not just that adoption piece, what do you think needs to be, especially at a local level, what do you think the focus needs to be to make sure that each community is getting their needs addressed and making sure that they're able to understand what their options are and then be able to get the services that they need?
Mm-hmm. I think one of the reasons this issue is just feels so intractable has felt that way for so long has a lot to do with the time and energy and resources it takes to create those relationships with more local entities from the federal level to the local level, and that every state has different laws in place that either support community networks or, you know, the expansion of infrastructure. Some of them have barriers that prevent it from happening. So I think there's got to be, we have to put more energy, resources, and effort into that coordination between the federal government and state and local to make sure that each community is getting its needs met. And one of the principles of our working group for a long time has been that local investment, local ownership of this infrastructure is what ultimately helps solve some of these issues around access and certainly adoption. But placing that, making that a priority, I think is really essential, but it does take that extra step, that extra effort, and the planning ahead of time to know that that's where we're headed. So
Yosef, I saw you nodding a little bit. I'm wondering if you'd like to also respond, especially, you know, what should that coordination look like, that communication between, the federal government and local leaders as we see this new tranche of money coming in?
Yeah, I think Whitney really hit the nail on the head when she said coordination. That's really one of the things we've lacked for years around digital equity issues. We've seen some success stories at the state and local level of different communities trying different things out, whether it's getting devices, refurbished devices to certain low-income households, or different digital literacy, digital inclusion classes. But we haven't had that sole arbiter or that sole entity at the federal level that's trying to connect the dots and get all the success stories in one place. So we know what's working in one community could work in another community. So when we have this Digital Equity Act funding in the infrastructure bill, I think one of the things we're gonna have to figure out through the implementation phase is how can the Department of Commerce or some other entity within government play the role of digital equity coordinator, where they are collecting success stories from across the country, as well as stories of things that may not be as workable or may not be as effective, and actually put together a digital equity plan or framework of here are the basic things that all communities should do when it comes to making sure all households have the tools and resources they need to effectively connect online. What are the basic skill sets that we should be pushing for in the next phase of digital equity and digital inclusion? What are the basic resources that everyone needs? How can we make sure that certain training programs can become models if indeed that's proven to work from community to community? So again, this is some of the things we'll have to think about post-implementation and during implementation as we think about the next programs and the next phase of these issues.
And Hannah, you know, as Yosef mentioned, one thing may work in one city might not work in another. I'm sure in an educational system in schools that may the same logic applies. So when you think about different school districts in different cities trying to find what works and best for their students, their educators, what should be kept in mind, especially as we think about getting students connected both in and out of the classroom?
I think the biggest thing is I think knowing your student population and knowing your students and what are the challenges they face and what are the contexts they're working with. And I think that can help to understand, like, what are the poles in the community that can help connect them? What's the role of grocery stores? What's the role of different religious organizations? What's the role of other community partners? Like, who are the poles in the community? And what are the challenges? I think, as Yosef said, be it income or language or like lack of support in the home who have, or lack of family members in the home who have sufficient digital literacy, and really knowing what the challenges are, or they're super mobile. I think your solutions look very different if you have someone who is changing where they live or has housing instability or is living in a unit that might not be recognized by an internet provider than if you have a community that is not connected for a different reason. So I think just understanding who your population is, what are the challenges they face, and how does that play into why they may or may not be connected is really at the core of how you seek to address it.
And for providers, Jonathan, what are some of the challenges to identifying, consumers' potential needs and understanding how to communicate with them? What are some successful ways to kind of overcome those barriers and make sure that providers know their customers and customers know their providers?
Well, the good thing about like cable providers and internet providers is we're the most, I think we might be some of the most trusted people in a community. You know, you have these local systems that have been there forever. You let the cable guy into your house. You don't let anybody else into your house, but if the cable guy comes to change your internet, you get in the house. You go to a local baseball game, a soccer game, like the cable companies, the internet companies always there as a sponsor. Their employees are members of the community. And I think just really making sure that we're leveraging that relationship we have with the community is the way that we, and that means that, you know, when I say we go to a school and we go to a community center, we go to a pastor, like that's one of our employees' kids' schools. It's one of our, you know, one of our spouses' wives or, you know, or husbands who's a pastor, it's a priest, it's a, you know, it's someone we know from being at every board meeting, at the school that we know, the board members there. And just leveraging those relationships that we already have and that trust we have in the community, the best way to identify and address this issue. It's really hard when you have these big programs come down that don't have that local relationship. And so I think just leveraging local relationships is critical.
So how challenging has it been, or has it been challenging at all to be able to communicate to communities that you serve, you know, this is the emergency broadband benefit program. This is how you apply for it, and trying to get that information out to them, where it may sound, a little unfamiliar at first because it is such a big program and it's temporary. So how have you been trying to get this information out to them, and what kind of success and challenges are you seeing?
I haven't had trouble distributing information about it. People knew about it. I've spent more money trying to get the people approved for the subsidy on project management and customer experience side than I have gotten in subsidies, I think. I've got multiple project managers on calls almost all the time trying to fix the approval system. It's not an ideal mechanism for running a subsidy program. And so that's the biggest hurdle there. Communicating in the community is pretty straightforward. Being able to actively use it's been a bigger frustration.
So then looking forward into this next program, what do you think needs to change to be able to make that process smoother?
I think the best thing was if they approved like blocks of communities, like, and then did one-offs for, you know, exceptions outside of it. You can identify an entire area where every home in that census block or census block group should be covered by emergency broadband benefit just based on what we know from census data and other demographic information. Like, just approve the whole area. And if it's an address in that, let us, you know, let a provider register that address. And then if it's outside of there, let them use in one-off basis. But, you know, having to do this on a one-off when it's a community problem is not ideal.
So Whitney, thinking about this from a rural community's perspective, would something like that be feasible? And would, do you think that that would boost adoption, especially in rural communities where they may not have been able to enroll in, for example, the EBB program?
I think if the infrastructure is there and the providers are there and have that relationship, I think that makes a whole lot of sense. I mentioned at the top, just it's been kind of difficult to navigate EBB with rural people and places, in part because they don't have their providers represented through it, or they get caught up in that application and it falls apart as they're trying to apply. In fact, I'm eligible for that benefit, and I stopped halfway through the application because it wasn't working out for various reasons, for barriers that made it more complex. So having a it does make sense to me that making a block approval process for whole counties and communities makes a whole lot of sense.
And, not just thinking about these temporary programs that are available, especially for low-income consumers, when you think about the permanent ones like the Lifeline program, which it aims to address the affordability issue for consumers, that still has a relatively low or lower than most would like, enrollment rate. And Yosef, I'm wondering, why do you think there is such a low participation rate in Lifeline, and what are some potential solutions to getting more folks that are eligible enrolled in the program?
Yeah, so I think there are a couple of things there. One, the Lifeline program has been around for years, since the 1980s under the Reagan administration. Broadband was only introduced into Lifeline during the Obama administration in 2016. So it's still a relatively new addition to the program. That being said, if you're looking specifically at some of the policy and regulatory changes that have happened in the Lifeline program over the last few years, it's been incredibly volatile. Just in terms of the legal authority to even include broadband in Lifeline has been uncertain the past couple of years. If you're looking at the service standards and what consumers can expect from Lifeline, and if providers are going to be in the program or not, that's been uncertain the past couple of years. But moving forward and looking back as well, the Lifeline program has been primarily a program participated through certain types of wireless providers. So we haven't had the big providers like Comcast or Verizon or others like that really participate in a way that they have been participating in EBB and presumably would be participating in ACP, the Affordable Connectivity Program. And again, that's been because of some of the regulatory decisions or lack of decisions that have kept that program very focused on certain types of providers. But moving forward, I would say that Lifeline still plays a critical role for a couple of reasons, one of which is that it's still providing voice services to households that are really reliant on those types of communication services, not just broadband. So as we figure out how to reform Lifeline and make it workable along with ACP and other affordability programs, we have to think about the types of providers that are already providing service in those programs, the eligibility criteria for that program, and the types of services that we can expect.
And, another thing that I'd like to discuss with everyone, and Whitney, we can start with you and then anyone else who would like to join in. We all know President Joe Biden this week, he designated acting chairwoman Jessica Rosenworcel as the permanent chair of the FCC, and he nominated Gigi Sohn to fill that fifth seat. So, with that in mind, and there will potentially be a full, commission again, what kind of steps do you think the FCC will be in a position to take when it comes to addressing the broadband adoption gap? And what kind of proposals will you be looking to see, or what would you like to see?
Yeah, I'm really heartened by these appointments, in part because both of these women have been longtime advocates for digital equity and have really collaborated with a lot of those local partners. So they are an example of federal coordination at a local level in some ways, and have a, I think, have a good grip on a lot of the inequities that we know exist across the spectrum. You know, going forward, I'm hopeful that, you know, we get to revisit Title II, that we get to talk again about net neutrality, that we're going to talk about, you know, new maps and really calling, understanding what the problem is so that we can truly address it. Yeah, I'm just really heartened by what they represent as appointees right now.
And Hannah, what would you like to see the commission do when it comes to addressing that adoption gap and, you know, whether it's looking at more permanent funding like we have with the EBB, trying to figure out how that works, you know, revisiting E-rate to see if we can get more students connected that way. What kind of actions would you like to see them take?
I think it's just important to make sure that equity is part of, and funding for equity is part of the conversation. I think back to what Jonathan said of, he spent more on the customer service side and the support side of thing and triaging problems than on the subsidy that he got for connecting households. And I've worked with municipalities that said, okay, ABB is coming. We want to make sure that our residents are taking advantage of this program. We would love to print flyers where this is the information of how to apply and FAQs. And then they go, well, how are we going to get the money for it? And are going out to philanthropic organizations to try and raise those funds. And while that is helpful, it is not a long-term solution. And so I think recognizing just the cost associated with both for providers and community organizations and institutions to support, and even libraries managing a slew of hotspots and check out and check in, making sure that there is the funding for the program management, for the support and assistance for students, for creating materials that are in multiple languages that are addressing the needs and speaking to the language in terms of verbiage too of the families and households is really important.
And Jonathan, what role do you see, you know, a full commission, you know, being able to take when it comes to addressing the adoption gap?
I think modernizing some of their practices. So, you know, fixing some of these, you know, the reverse auction is not always the best way to introduce infrastructure and fix infrastructure problems. You know, there's the lifeline. You have to be an ETC. A lot of states have abdicated that assignment process. They have to go to the FCC. Small operators don't necessarily have the resources to do that. You have to have, for us to get the emergency broadband benefit programs funding, we had our DC lawyers working with our in-house lawyers and our regulatory teams to pull together the package to put together to file, and then to maintain it and get it set up. Like, we, you know, it's not an insignificant expense. You know, kind of taking some of those barriers down, modernizing the infrastructure, the systems that we use to interact with the FCC. I think is the more we can do to encourage new entrants into this space that makes them feel more comfortable and that they don't have a lot at risk by trying to solve these digital equity problems would be great. I don't think people understand the cost and the expertise and the risk that goes into being an internet operator. It's a very expensive on the infrastructure side to build out real infrastructure to people's homes. It takes a lot of expertise to do that and to provide it, especially ubiquitously, where you can put your signal in every single home. It takes a lot of work and a lot of money. And there might be some, you know, reducing the feeling of risk for smaller operators in these communities that want to go out and build and participate in this. It would be a great first step.
And last but not least, Yosef, with the full commission, what kind of actions are you hoping to see when it comes to really addressing the adoption gap? Oh, and I believe you're muted.
Sorry about that. Yeah, we're really excited by the announcements of acting chair Rosenworcel designating as full chair, and Gigi Sohn getting nominated to be a commissioner. And really, with both of them, along with Commissioner Starks, who has championed digital equity, inclusion, and affordability, we're really expecting a total revamping at the FCC with those three leading the way. One of the things that has been the case the past 4 years under prior leadership at the FCC is really a focus on industry and industry needs, and not so much a focus on community needs and needs of those at the margins. So when we're talking about broadband policymaking the next few years, one of the things that we're hopeful to see under new leadership of the commission is centering the voices of marginalized communities. How can we get equity and affordability introduced in all types of broadband policy rulemakings and decisions at the FCC? At the same time, how can we also get voices that we haven't heard from to speak before the FCC, whether it's at meetings or hearings or other types of convenings? The FCC now will potentially have millions more dollars to stand up the ACP program. How can the FCC play a coordinating role in making sure that communities that really need these programs are benefiting from it, whether it's virtual convenings or other types of actions to make sure that they're hearing from all types of stakeholders?
Well, thank you all for joining us today. And let me again thank our panelists for their wonderful thoughts this afternoon. And so now I'd like to turn things back over to Matt for any final remarks.
All right. Thank you, Gabriella. It's just so nice to have you all here today to talk about these important issues and how we can work better to include more people and get them to adopt broadband. We certainly know that our ACA Connects members are part of the solution, as they have been over the last couple of years. And we look forward to working with you and your organizations. We appreciate your unique perspectives today, and the fact that everybody here is working to make this important issue happen, as we look forward to working with a new commission and as a result of what will be taking place in the infrastructure bill. So thank you to our panelists and moderator, Gabriella, Jonathan, Hannah, Yosef, and Whitney. Just really great to have you here. We appreciate your words and your thoughts and perspectives. Thank you also to Ross Lieberman, our own Ross Lieberman, and our good folks at Cartesian, regarding the review of our report on adoption issues across the country. It's an issue we care about a lot at ACA Connects, and you'll see lots more as we move forward together. But thanks for being here, everybody. We wish you a great day, and we hope to see you back soon on another ACA Connects webinar. Take care, everybody. Bye now.